Okay, good evening. Hope everyone's doing good. I hope you've had a great day, and want to thank you for tuning in on Wednesday night for our little time of Bible study. Just want to remind you of a couple quick things. First of all, don't forget candy. We need as much candy as we can get. That's coming up both the 26th for the community one that we're going to participate in this year, and for the 31st, which will be the one that's here, our drive-through Trunk or Treat Fall Festival of Hope. It's going to be a powerful time, and I just want to encourage you to invite everybody you possibly can. It's going to be awesome. And Pelicans is going to be here. We're going to have a prayer time. We're going to have cars with candy. We're going to have pictures. It's going to be music. It's just going to be a great, great, great day. And so thank you for participating in that with us. Then I also want to encourage you, if you haven't already been able to participate in the prisoner packets, please help us with that. We've had great, great, great blessings from that in the past. We're going to collect those through November the 1st, which will be here very soon. And so we just want to encourage you to be a part of that with us. Remember Ernest, who got saved and grew in his faith and became a missionary of this church to reach others in the prisons, and now he's free. And we're just thankful for that. Not just free from prison, but free in Jesus Christ. And if the Son sets you free, you're free indeed. Those only cost somewhere between $8 and $10, but what an investment. And I just hope that you'll be a part of that with us. And then just quickly, some good news. Our new camera, it's been a blessing. Many have contributed to that, and it's almost taken care of, and so we're thankful for that as well. What a great investment. This week, it's almost been double of what we've seen in the past, and so what a blessing. Tonight, though, I want us to get serious and just look at one verse tonight, and it's going to be in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 8 is where we're going to look. But if you will, let's pray together. Dear Lord, I love you, and I thank you for this day, and I thank you for giving us this time together. I thank you for your word. I thank you for the hope that we have in your Son, Jesus Christ. And Lord, today I just pray that you'll keep our eyes on you in everything that we do. I love you, and I give you all the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 8. And as you're turning there, I want you to think about, when is the greatest things that happened ever in your life? When did those occur? For maybe a little baby, maybe you think the first time they eat by themselves or eat table food. Maybe as they get older, when they go to school. As they get a little bit older, when they graduate from elementary or graduate from middle or graduate from high school, or maybe when they get their license. There's those markers in our life where great things happen. As adults, maybe when you get your first job, your first home, your first car, you get excited about different things. And I want you to think about that. But then I also want you to think about, what is it in your life that allows you to see the grace of God abound? What is it? What is it that brings that about? Is it when you go through a difficult time and you see that he still loves you and that he didn't leave you and he didn't forsake you? Is it that you see healing come across your path and maybe you personally or maybe a family member? Maybe answered prayer. Maybe you got a Bible verse that just really ignited your faith and his grace was abounding then for you as well. Whatever it is, tonight, I want you to think about this verse. And it's 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 8, and it says, "And God is able to make every grace overflow to you, so that in every way, always having everything you need, you may excel in every good work." God is able. He's able to do far more than what we could ever imagine. He is able to do great things in our life. I want you to think of those three things that are mentioned there. First of all, that his grace overflows. Think about it. God gives more grace than what you and I could ever imagine. He gives way more grace than what you and I could ever imagine. Grace overflows over the struggles in our life. It overflows. We can't even explain how great his grace is, and we truly need his grace. He has given us so much. Charles Spurgeon and Joseph Parker both had churches in London in the 19th century. On one occasion, Parker commented on the poor condition of children admitted to Spurgeon's orphanage. It was reported to Spurgeon, however, that Parker criticized the orphanage itself. Spurgeon blasted Parker the next week from the pulpit. The attack was printed in the newspaper and became the talk of the town. People flocked to Parker's church to the next Sunday to hear his rebuttal. And here's what Parker said. I understand that Dr. Spurgeon is not in his pulpit today, and that this is the Sunday they used to take an offering for the orphanage. I suggest we take an offering here instead. The crowd was delighted, and the ushers had to empty the collection plates three times. Later that week, there was a knock at Parker's study, and it was Spurgeon. He said, "You know, Parker, you practiced grace on me. You've given me not what I deserve, but you've given me what I needed." God always seems to do that. He always seems to do that. He gives us way more than what we could ever imagine. I think back to the times where I was able to coach soccer and hope to be able to do that again in the future as well, if there's enough for a team. But in those times in coaching soccer, I think about all the kids that have gone through and been on my team and how they gave me grace as I coached. But then after high school, now that some of them are getting married, I've been able to participate in a number of the services, but I've also been able to be there with those students, with those players. And we always get our picture together and encourage one another. And we do that because there's a lot of grace that has overflowed. There's a lot of times where we prayed through and just encourage one another. God's with us in the good times and in the tough times. Boy, what great love was practiced between Spurgeon and Parker. And what love is needed in the churches even today, where that love needs to spread. It needs to spread like wildfire. It needs to be so much more than what it has become. And then it says in our passage in verse 8 as well, it says that you'll have everything you need. God provides everything that we need. There have been plenty of stories of missionaries across the world who don't know where their next bill is going to be taken care of. Pastor friends of mine have had bills come up that they weren't expecting, and in the mail, an exact amount is shipped to them or mailed to them. It's an amazing thing. Heard a story of a missionary who didn't have food and didn't know if they were going to eat, and he had his family get the plates, get the cups, get everything together, set at the table. And as they sat at the table, then they were able to realize that there was a truck that broke down in front of the house, and it had some extra food that they were able to eat for that evening. We sometimes don't think about the greatness of God and how that helps us see that God did it. God's hand is at work. And sometimes we're faithful only faithful only to Him as much as we think we can. We trust Him only as much as maybe we think we want. But God has so much more. His grace, it abounds, but it is His desire to take care of everything we need. And notice it doesn't say wants, but our needs. Now sometimes He takes care of those wants as well, but He does take care of our needs. He makes sure that we are able to eat. There's a story of a tool company that manufactured drill bits. And faced with financial losses, the company got together with the executives and said, "We got to figure out how to increase the demand for drill bits." And so he challenged the men, "What can we do to revive the drill bit market?" And after embracing some silence, one of the members of the team just said, "Sir, the market isn't for bits, it's for holes." And the story kind of goes on to say that they were overlooking the truth. You see, people don't go buy bits because they want to buy drill bits. They go get drill bits because they want to make holes. And a customer doesn't necessarily buy a product. They buy the satisfaction of what they want. And as a Christian, we need to realize that we're not going in life to get what we want. We're getting what we need, a personal relationship with Christ. And it changes our perspective. It changes who we are, and in accomplishing those needs, God shows us that He also has the greater plan, the greater purpose. Then the third one here is the idea of excelling in every good work. God enables us as individuals to do the work that He's called us to do. You know, this church, Northside Baptist, is not my church. I get to pastor the church, but that's a responsibility. It's not my church. It's God's church. And every single one of us, every single person has a responsibility to be a part of the work. We need to excel in the work. And when we work together, The work is accomplished. When we work separately, it doesn't happen like it's supposed to. We have got to continue to come together to excel, not to just accomplish, not to just accomplish the work, but even excel. God has that plan. Think about why we do what we do. It's the impact of the kingdom work, not just for us or any individual. It's about what the kingdom has. I heard it once said that a farmer once said, the hardest thing about milking cows is they never stay milked. I bet my friend out in at Calvary in Nice's area would probably agree with that statement. They never stay milked. The great thing about serving as a church is there's lost people all over our community, all over our state, all over our nation, all over our world. There's opportunity to talk to people about Jesus all the time. But are we doing it? Are we making the most of that opportunity? Are we going and sharing with people like what we should? Too often we kind of look at things like the guy in the elevator who said, I don't know what makes my boss tick, but I sure know what makes him explode. See, we're looking at things from a wrong perspective. We're seeing what gets people angry instead of what satisfies the need. There are people in our city that need to hear about Christ. We have to do our part. We have to share. We have to go the extra mile. We have to do whatever it takes to share Jesus Christ. And in understanding what this verse says, we understand that not only does he give us an overflowing or abounding grace, but he also takes care of our needs, and he also allows us to excel in the good work. Listen to the verse again. It says, and God is able. It doesn't say we're able. God is able to make every grace overflow to you so that in every way, always having everything you need, you may excel in the good work. That's what it's about. That's what we're supposed to be doing. Verse 9 even goes an extra step. It says, as it is written, he scattered, he gave to the poor, his righteousness endures forever. God has a plan for you and for me. And we've got to take some time and step back and just think about the grace of God. We've got to think about what he's given us and all the grace that he's given us. We have been given much, and we need to abound in him. We need to be all about the work. And not because it's the work, but because of his grace. See, if it's work, it becomes a chore. But you give to ones who maybe have given to you, or you give out of love. And when you give out of love, it's so much different than feeling like you have to. If we're doing something because we have to, we're missing the point. May we not ever miss the point of why we do what we do. Abounding grace, more than what we could ever imagine. Let's not miss it. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we love you and we thank you for this day. We thank you for giving us just a few minutes on a Wednesday night to gather together and to seek your face and to just be a part of some time in the Word. And Lord, I pray tonight that there will be people that will participate and be a part of this time. And I thank you, Lord, that your Word never returns null and void. And so, Lord, tonight, I ask that you help us to just be in the Word, be people of the Word, and be people sharing the Word. Thank you for all you've done for us and all you're going to do. I love you and I give you all the glory. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to thank you for joining in tonight and being a part of this Bible study. If you join in, please let us know. It does a lot to encourage that work. And let us know that you're connected. If you can, I want to encourage you, don't just stay home. Come and be with us live. Yes, this is a way. And if you're in another state, it's a lot more impossible to be live. But if you're here in Orangeburg, close by, we want you to come and be live with us. 9:30, 11:15, come and join us. Come and be a part of what's going on. We want to see you. There's a great work that we have in this city, and there's not enough churches to do the work. So come help us do whatever it takes to share Jesus Christ. 9:30, 11:30, Sunday night, 6 o'clock, online right now. Hopefully not too much longer. We're working to get some other things going on. Don't miss the Fall Festival of Hope. And let's continue to do whatever it takes to share Jesus. Thank you for joining in tonight. And I hope and pray that all is good with you. If you need some encouragement and you haven't heard from us in a while, please let me know. I'll be there. I enjoy visiting. Some are not comfortable with visiting yet, and that's okay. But we want to encourage one another as well. It's important. It's what we're supposed to do. and I hope that you have a great rest of your evening. God bless you, and continue to charge on. We'll see you soon.